it was really exciting and really happy because we were quite involved with it already, and it felt really great to get a bit more involved in making some of the decisions and stuff behind the scenes and how the movie was going to progress while still retaining Ollie's vision.
Yeah, I was honoured really. I'd not really done much producing before, so excited but a little bit sort of nervous about what responsibilities you'd sort of be taking on. But no, it was good. I was excited.
Well, like with what we were doing before co-producing, it's the making of the film with everybody and seeing it all get made and come together. When promoted to co-producer, we also had a bit more, we already had some input already, but when we became co-producers, we had a lot more opportunity to put in some ideas or suggestions and how things would look and have more contact with Ollie about exactly what's going to happen, and he would tell us more about some of his plans and ideas and suggestions and how the film was going to look.
Yeah, just having more of an insight into how it was going to go really, and sort of locations as well, coming up for all we should film it here in this place instead of that place, and that would be really good to do something there, and so just in terms of switching it up a little bit as well. We had more ideas of that to suggest to him.
And we were in contact with him a lot more about discussions. Yeah. And he was telling us more about his plans and stuff. Yeah. And all three of us putting our input in. We came up with lots of new Bond references. And we also came up with a couple of other references to other pieces of media we like. To see if you can try and spot a couple of them. But, mostly Bond references, but a couple of other stuff as well here and there. A couple of ideas thrown into the story, suggestions here and there, some character motivations and progressions, and how the movie was going to go, and even what the final cut is going to look like. We've even had some exclusive insights to rough cuts.
Yeah, I think some of the things that I've brought in, I think the major scene, the red scene, the red room scene. I've had a little bit of input into how that came to be, and
story wise
how that came to be, and what went on in that scene, and sort of who the main focus of that scene is compared to who the main focus of that scene was. And that was sort of a turning point in the story, really, because by making it about that scene about one character rather than another character, it kind of shaped the rest of the story. So that was really exciting.
Kind of helped streamline it a bit more and focus it.
It's a very exposition-heavy scene.
And it's a long scene as well.
And the backstory to that character, that red scene is all about, the kind of his motivations and why he does what he does. So I think I've had good input into that character and why he is how he is, and so that was fun to do. I just suggested it to Ollie because it just made a bit more sense, and we both refined it and both sort of talked about it. But that was my majority of my input was in that character.
Well, I think as well, like with your own characters, you've both brought a lot of comedy to the film. You've obviously been acting in a few roles.
Which has been fun.
It's been very fun.
It was a lot of fun just playing the role of the character. Because when we were filming on set, on location, and we were channeling our actors' roles more than producers, it was mainly when we were coming up with ideas and suggestions that were more for those moments where the producer side kicks in. But at that time, we're mostly focusing on playing the characters and the roles and so on.
Yeah, because unlike the director and actors are mainly on set, the producer role is mainly behind the scenes, like off set. So it wasn't as difficult because you only have to, when you're in the producer role and you're sitting having the discussions and you're thinking, you're not thinking about you as the character when you're giving inputs, you're thinking about the character, and then when you're, you know, what the character does and everything, but when you are on set playing the character, you, your producer side isn't there, and it's your actor side playing with the character and being the character. So yeah, they're quite separate, unlike when you're a director and actor. That's when it gets more complicated.
Because you, Ollie, you were offered your role as Nick Knack after being offered the co-producer.
Yeah.
Whereas Nick has been acting in the second one.
Well, one of my characters was in the second one, but the other one came about a little bit later on as well. Yeah, it's been a ton of fun, been great. He knows exactly what he's doing most of the time, and he has a great clear vision for the story, even with the changes here and there, and that's not even with anybody else that's making suggestions. But he's always very good about that, by the way. And yeah, he's got a real clear vision about what he wants, and I think it's a really great vision, and what he's got planned for the story, and even and the little changes here and there. It's all been great, and it's been great to have little bits of input in there as well.
Thank you.
I think it's also good because even though he has the clear vision, he lets...
He's willing to let others in take part.
Yeah, and sort of make suggestions. But as well, like, it's been fun having the meetings and stuff and being on set because you're just funny to work with. You're great to work with, and we always have a laugh. And even though we do work and get things done, it's fun, and we have a laugh.
And we may disagree on occasions, but
it's always civil. It's never like an all out argument. It's just I think this, I think that. Well, let's try and find the medium ground. But no, it's been really fun actually. You know, because we always laugh on set, but also in meetings, like producer meetings for the producer side of it. We're always laughing and having fun, and, you know?
Chilling sometimes.
So
It's never felt like a pressure.
No, it's never pressured. It's more, we've sort of got to get this done. It's in the back of our minds, but it's not like a... Because the meetings themselves are fun and productive, it doesn't feel like a chore going into it. It's not like, oh, God, we've got to get this done.
Yeah, there's a nice environment.
We have to get this done, but we're excited to get it done. We're excited to do it. Rather than,
this is so boring.
Because you two share a similar passion, similar level of passion to me.
Yeah.
Obviously, I'm devoting a bit more time to it, but since you've come along as co-producers, I feel you two have actually stepped up quite a lot, and you've taken on the responsibility, and, you know, you never asked to be co-producers, I just chose you. But, you know, I really appreciate the effort that's been put in, so thank you very much. But we're not done yet.
Well, I would say it's sort of the story structure. I'd say like the emotion. I'd say it's fun. Well, it's funny like the others, which it keeps that consistent. But it's got a lot more emotion behind it, and I think it's not that the other films didn't have heart. But it has a lot of heart and soul.
It's like, more driven that way.
You can feel that. Whereas the others, you can look at them, and although there is the emotion, especially in the second one and the end of the second one. So I feel like that's a good continuation from that.
It's evolved.
Yeah, the first one, and you can see it's like the first one is sort of very much the comedy, but with a little bit of like drama, and. And then the next one has a bit more sort of emotion, as in, you know, the family side of it. And then this one just has, you know, it goes deeper into that. It goes deeper into all the characters and how they fit together in the family. So I think this is, it's almost like the, if you watch this, you understand as well the other two films, the whole journey. Because you get almost, it's almost a bit of a prequel in a way, as well as a sequel. Because you get to find out what happened before the first one to make the first one happen,
and so forth.
Also, like, scale-wise, it's the biggest of the three. It's huge.
It's quite big. It's
the most people, the most locations.
The most action.
Yeah.
Most stuff going on. Even the stuff that's not that action-y or fast-paced, not much going on, is still quite important sometimes, whether to that scene or for the film as a whole, within the whole franchise, trilogy, sorry. But yeah, it's quite a big scale film. There's a lot going for it, and the drive that we've all put into the film, and I think it's gonna come out really spectacular. When the film comes out, it'll be about 5.5 years after the, or just over 5.5 years after the second film. And it's been its production would have started 5 years prior to the release, minus the roughly near 2 year hiatus because of some issues behind the scenes.
Yeah, not to do with COVID.
No, that came later. And actually, that's what brought it back.
In a weird way,
In a weird way. But in terms of the general production-wise, near 5 years of production, over five and a half, when the film comes out, wait since the second one's release. Yeah, I think it's been worth it a lot, and it's been a real passion to put it together and make it, and the struggle to put it together. This last year, since it came back, I think has been our most productive and progressive year of filming and actually trying to get it done and getting new ideas on board, changing a little bit, getting some new people on board, just trying to push it to make the finish line, even if we didn't hit the release date we later decided to aim for. We're still pushing it towards that end, and I think we will hit that date, but if not exactly that date, it won't be too far behind, because we are close to finishing at time of recording, and the last roughly year or so, well, not quite a year, by the time the film comes out, it'll be around a year since it was brought back. So
yeah,
this general year of production has been our most progressive, because we want to finish it, we want to get it done, and we want to make it amazing.
And working under the conditions of COVID, obviously the restrictions eased, but still, we haven't done a massive group filming for this one.
Yeah, no,
not for 50 slices.
I think it's worth the 6 year wait, because it will be the biggest.
Yeah.
And the most emotive. So I think, it is worth the wait. And as regards, COVID, it has been difficult to get, even though the restrictions were sort of, that people are still rightly wary, and we've been a COVID cautious production.
Especially when we started back up.
It's hard to get everyone in the same right room to film. Some scenes.
Even without COVID, it's still difficult to do that time-wise.
But the luxury of this film is that the story is multi-stranded. Different characters are separated in the scene.
But to get some of them in the same scene, filmed differently, has been difficult in terms of filming angles,
lighting,
and also just remembering as someone behind the camera where everyone else was, and also helping the people in front of the camera who are acting to essentially no one. They're acting against no one.
Like today, we have, for the second time, reshooting that tent scene.
Yeah, it was the third time we shot that scene.
Yeah.
they basically, trying to help somebody act with someone who's not there is also quite challenging. And also acting, being in those scenes, I mean, when you are acting to someone who, or a lot of people who aren't there, like the main scene, the Red Room scene, and everyone's sort of...
Supposed to be there,
And you're basically, it's when you're filming it, it's just you, and you're trying to remember where everybody was.
And falls on me to remember who is where. That's why I planned that scene the way I did.
And that's difficult as well, because when you've not got the person there to play against as well, your performance can, like, you've really got to bring your performance out. It's harder. You've got to think about it more. That has been. That's been challenging. It's been hard as regards that, on both sides, trying to help someone do it and try and doing it yourself.
I think the Red Room scene was one of the most difficult, not just for the logistics of filming, but the writing of it, because, as you say, we changed the focus of it, and it suddenly fell into place. But because there's so many people in it, so much going on.
There's so much dialogue.
That's, and it's a very exposition-heavy scene, and it's a long scene. It's the longest scene in the film, so to keep it entertaining is going to be very difficult.
I think what's going to be revealed will keep the audience interested because it's quite a lot of interesting stuff. Yeah, it's there's quite a lot of talking, but I think what's going to be revealed will be quite interesting to the audience and it will keep them interested in what's going on, even though everyone's just talking about it.
Yeah.
But I think it'll be interesting enough for them to keep interest. Well, in this film's case, we had a lot of people availability issues across the rough near 5 years of production.
The earlier stages, but pre-COVID, we had a lot of availability issues.
Yeah, 2017 through 19, especially 19.
Yeah.
17 through 19's production blocks, especially 2019, had a lot of availability issues. In terms of the 2021-2 production block, it's mostly the Red Room stuff we've had to do in terms of the logistics and stuff and getting it all sorted out together. Mm. And also that tent scene we mentioned.
Yeah.
We had to film for the
fucking tent.
We had to film that today.
And poor Ollie's actually had to do that like four times. Because he did yours separately, mine separately, and twice together.
Yeah. And then there's other characters there's like other Tom Elgee and we can't say spoilers, but
I've been in that field.
Jake Cannon.
I've been in that field filming the tent scene like 5-6 times.
We were there the other day with Jake as well.
Yep.
So. Yeah, if you include the other actors, for me it'd be 5 then because I'm with Tom,
including the reshoots.
Oh, mine would be 4. Sorry.
Yeah.
So my shots individually, then the two of us together. And then Tom's bits, Tom LG.
I mean, I think one of the most difficult things here has been the not having everyone together to do certain scenes. It would have been absolutely great because then you've not just got camera angles, but it also helps to have people in the same shot and it helps actors act against people.
Mm.
I think that's been one of the most difficult things that I think has happened is that it's been really great when we have been able to be together and bounce off each other acting as well.
Because
I don't know about you, but filming the Red Room scene was a lot harder than filming the tent scene in a way.
Yeah, there's lots of stuff.
Because when we're talking and acting off each other, it's...
Yeah. Yeah, knowing where to look and knowing who's where, that's the tricky. And with you, Nick, playing two characters in that scene.
I mean, it's not just that, it's having someone, not just where to look, but having that kind of...
Those moments.
Those moments where you sort of, you can look at someone and go,
Yeah, because everyone's relying on me to basically tell them
where to go and where to look.
But where to actually have that person there as well to act off of is really helpful. So I think, in some ways that tent seems more difficult, but in some ways, as an actor, I think having the person there, and I think actually the parts where we have had people, more than one person there and doing it, I think have tended to be the easier shoots. Yeah.
Like the stuff with Jinx. That was a great weekend. Most of us were there. That's the biggest crowd we've had since pre-COVID.
It was us three, Neve on both days, Brendan on the second day. Simon on the second day.
Yeah.
And G.
The opening-ish, well, the opening in the forest.
In the woods, yeah.
And also the scene in here before everybody had to do it separately. With that starts with you and with Pierce and Connery.
Oh, the opening, yes.
That was great.
That scene we can't talk about.
Apart from the fact we filmed that as one of our earlier.
I mean, people know there are scenes
back
with you
in the autumn of 17
with Pierce and Connery. So the part with Pierce and Connery in this room at the beginning, where there are clearly multiple people in the room in the same shot.
Yeah.
Parts
of that scene had to be finished. Yeah. In the 21-22 block.
Yeah.
But the main point that you were talking about was filmed back in...
So I'm hoping the editing is seamless.
That's the thing that is
pretty cool.
Yeah. And it's one of those where it's It's one of the ones that went the best, and you kind of...
It set a good precedent for the...
You're having a laugh, and it's like the whole cast and crew vibe rather than just acting as...
And it's great that shots from 2017, 18, 19 work really well with shots from 2021.
And they've still made it into the film.
Yeah.
Well, we've had to do a lot of reshoots for this one. Yeah. Way more. Mm-hmm. I think with Christmas bonding, we only reshot one scene. We were quite lucky, really.
Yeah, we did some pick-up bits and reshoots a little bit later on.
Yeah.
Like, the autumn of 2016, we reshot some of the barman's moments.
Yeah, but that was minor. Compared to this, like...
This is half the... Like, a third of the film's been rewritten or reshot.
Yeah.
Or something.
But for the better, I say.
Yeah, I think it's going to... I already loved the script when I got it in 2017.
Yeah.
And now I think it's going to be even better. It's more refined, a bit more streamlined, and there's a lot more added stuff. I think there'll be quite a few surprises, apart from those in the know.
Yeah.
But I think, people who are watching this... without any knowledge or context of what's going on behind the scenes. They haven't got the scripts, they haven't seen any of the footage. All they've seen is maybe some
trailers,
teasers, and a couple of other promotion or behind-the-scenes stuff and interviews.
I think they'll be surprised at some things. Like, I think some points in the story that have been kept under wraps, I think people will be like, what?
So we're trying to be like a natural movie and TV series where are we hiding most of our spoilery stuff under wraps for the time being, and then when the movie comes out, it's gonna be great to see the revelations, the reveals, and so forth.
Absolutely
fun.
Yeah,
it'll be a joy to work with everybody again.
Yeah,
on whoever's films and so on.
Yeah.
It will be good. I mean, I think we work quite well as a team of producers. So, and working on just as well any position in the film. We're quite excited for future projects, actually.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep, definitely. I'm loving the acting.
Yeah.
Oh, it's great. Got a couple of last little bits of Manor in Scaramanga. Last couple of moments, and...
Sad to say goodbye?
Yeah, I guess. They've been fun roles. Barman is quite a comedic character. Scaramanga as well, to a lesser extent, but also quite a great character as well. And despite some comedic moments, he's also, like, one of the more straight people in the room. Not straight as in sexuality, straight as in serious... you've got the funny person and the straight person in comedy. And I think...
Have you enjoyed differentiating the characters?
Yeah, because Mallory's a lot more easygoing, while Scaramanga is a bit more tough. And later on, as we see, he's a lot... He can get angry quite easily.
Yeah, I think it's been fun. Sad to say goodbye to Nick Knack, but... It's been really fun. I mean, the whole day has been really, really good, and it was a good way to say goodbye. It was a good day to end on, good scene to end on. Actually, just get to release a lot of frustration as well. That was a good scene. It was a good goodbye. Really,
and putting the French accent to bed is going to be sad. So.
I think Nick Knack's going to be... I think Nick Knack's going to steal the show. It was green in the last film. It's going to be Nick Knack in this one.
Thank you very much, but I'm not sure about that. But no, it's...
Well, to be honest, there's a lot of characters up for that contest.
Yeah. Well, there are.
It is quite spoilery, but it's the one that's set outside with George Lazenby on a bench and then leads into something else, which I can't say, but it's a really great... These are some really great scenes.
Dramatic.
And dramatic with Lazenby and Scaramanga, and then Lazenby on his own, and then we finish with Scaramanga and Connery. And that's all I'll say.
Yeah, I do. I have a favourite scene, and it's technically... It's the last scene that Nick Knack is in the film. It's not the last one we have filmed today. We filmed it a while ago, but... Knick-knack's very last scene in the film is, I think, the first scene, funnily enough, I think I played Knick-knack, and that's my favourite. Mm. In the field. That's my favourite, but I also love
the stuff in the control room was the control room.
Knick-knack's control room was also fun.
It was very funny.
That was fun.
And creepy, if I may say.
Creepy. That was a really fun scene.
Very sinister.
There's been a lot of fun moments, but
Bringing the comedy out as well, because he is a villain. But
that's something that I love to play with. Like, he's sadistic, and he loves the villainy, but he has fun with it. Like, he's
got a bit of charm to him.
Yeah, he likes to toy with his kill. Really, he doesn't just kill them and go. Yeah.
Whereas Scaramanga is a straight assassin.
Whereas Scaramanga's the assassin.
He's too impatient.
He's an assassin. Knick-knack's a
serial killer. Yeah, yeah. And Dominic Green
enjoys it. Knick-knack enjoys the kill. Torturing them, toying with them.
Yeah.
And then
Green is just insane. Dead
with their bodies, you learn that it's not just after they've died. He does. He likes to make a thing out of that as well.
Yeah, it gives him pleasure. As Dominic Green is just a wild animal.
Yeah.
In a man's body.
Yeah.
So Knick-knack is like this dark and light. I've loved playing with that.
Yeah.
Dominic Green's like the Weasel in the Suicide Squad. He's an uncontrollable animal who will kill anybody gets in his way. But he does have some intelligence.
I think we're going to see a different side to him in this one. And
he
also
has a heart.
He has a heart. And we're going to see that as well with Judy Dench in this one. Whereas, those two characters, their journeys are slightly changing in this one.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Which is why new villains can come in take over the
That's the thing, because with Green, he's like this wild animal that does have a heart. Whereas Scaramanga just is an assassin, and then Knick-knack kind of is all charming but doesn't have a heart. He's dark. Knick-knack does not have a heart.
Mm-hmm.
He pretends he does. He's charming, but that's surface, and he doesn't have a heart.
Yeah, that's why he's my favourite character in the film. and your performance.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, no, seriously, the French accent is very good.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
And the way you deliver your lines.
I'm going to be a bit glad to put that a bit to bed, though.
Yeah. Too bad, because people are going to see it. People are going to see the finished film.
Put it to bed as in I'm finished.
Finished filming,
Oh, it's been quite fun, because we've been doing a lot of stuff to make the movie. Everybody getting together and filming.
Capturing memories.
Capturing lots of memories, there's been great moments.
So many laughs.
And great scenes.
So many laughs behind the scenes.
Lots of really great stuff.
I'm particularly proud of the behind the scenes stuff we got with Blofeld, Dan, the makeup. And also with Billy as Judy Dench.
I think the makeup's been interesting to do the behind the scenes for. But I think we've got behind the scenes of the car.
Yeah.
Everyone knows the car's going to be in it.
Yes.
Not spoiling, but we have got great behind the scenes of the car and filming the car chase.
Scene at the start of the film, or one of the scenes at the start of the film with Connery and Brosnan. We've got some good stuff with that. Got some good stuff with a couple of other scenes. We did some stuff earlier. Usually do a couple of stuff every now and again, and there's some really good stuff.
I'm sort of trying to grab people and do little interviews, so to take us from the start of production, from the first one, and basically talk about the making of all three of the films, and have people sort of, a bit like this, sort of conversational style like this, with people saying their like favourite scenes, their funny moments, and basically, talk about the behind the scenes. So it's going to be exploring like the behind the scenes, really, and sort of the troubles that we've had. So casting issues, people not being able to be available.
A couple of other logistical issues.
Yeah, and just sort of... getting to know again, like, the people that have made the film and
And sharing their experiences
of
it.
Yeah, and yeah, that's it. Sharing the experiences and making the films. And so, yeah. So what people, what all the cast and crew members have kind of thought about the making and, yeah, their experiences of being involved.
Because these are not the typical James Bond films. They are very very different.
Yeah, they're
very unorthodox.
So
that's for me what's made it special is that we are making a Bond film, but it's a parody. So we can have a laugh in it, and we know that we're making something that no one else has ever made.
Yeah.
And that's my defense of it. It may be bizarre, it may be weird, but it's original.
Oh, yeah. And that's the thing. It's kind of turned in from a pure parody into, like, its own story and its own thing.
It's kind of an epic now, isn't it?
It may be based on the Bond franchise and the Bond sort of, like, actors' names that have played Bond. But it's become its own thing with each actor that's put their own...
spin on each character of who are based on the actors.
They've put their bit of them in the character and their take and spin, like you said, and then the character has sort of evolved even more and it's come further from a parody and more to its own thing. And it's just, we have all the Bond references and so it's a Bond film, but it's
become more fantastical.
Not a Bond film.
At its heart, it's a drama.
Yeah.
It's a domestic drama with loads of silly James Bonds living in a house.
Yeah, that's how it started. James Bond's in a house having a family dinner.
Easy and simple family dinner, a bit of drama, like a soap, and then Blofeld comes in and ruins everything. And then the second film gets a bit more dramatic and a bit more serious here and there. But
and also more outrageous.
Yeah, also more outrageous. But they're also celebrating Christmas. They're all getting together.
Yeah.
It's a bit more drama, a little bit more soapy stuff, etc. And then shit goes down at the end again. Stuff goes down at the end, and then that leads us into the third film, which is more dramatic, more serious, but there's still lots of comedy and even more outrageous stuff. I won't say any more than that. But it's going to be a lot of great stuff in here, and it's this one's kind of like it's become its own thing by now.
And now it feels like it's really one massive story.
Yeah,
and it's one of three parts.
What we managed to do is tie it
I think we've got we've got everything we need now in terms of the story. Yeah, it was a ton of fun.
Yeah.
It took a while. It's taking a while to get the whole thing done, but it was worth every single moment. It was really great, really fun, and such an enjoyable production to work on when it was going really well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. I've been involved since the very first film.
Yeah.
And that, it's like, it is the end of an era. It's, it started with just one weekend of filming in one
for a house, 20-minute film.
20-minute film, and it was just 2 days on the weekend and got on with everyone. Everyone was having such a great time. It was so fun. And then to come back for the second one.
Yeah, which is my first one.
And, to meet new people, bigger cast. To have again just a ton of fun and have the story developed
and it does
feel sad kind of saying goodbye, not so much to Nick Knack because I've only been in it for one film to say goodbye to the characters that I've seen from the start, especially the ones played by the same actors because that keeps the thing but to say goodbye to those characters to say goodbye and finish the story. It's kind of bittersweet because I like how it ends and I think it's a great ending and it needs to end so that it doesn't
outstay its welcome.
That
was the whole reason to make it just a trilogy and not continue it into a fourth.
But it does feel sad that it is ending in a way. It's one of those bittersweet, like, oh yeah, it's good it's ending, kind of before, jump before you're pushed sort of thing.
Yeah.
While people still want more, leave. But yeah, I think watching it watching it back is going to be great with a lot of nostalgia and so yeah, I do
all the effort we put in.
Yeah, and I do. It's yeah, so it's bittersweet. It's bittersweet. It's kind of it's a nice goodbye, but then it's always sad to say goodbye. So
yeah.
I don't know what gets me the most at the moment. Maybe when I see the film, I might again when the more finalized version. I suppose
anything towards the end.
I suppose there is a scene towards the end where stuff goes down with Connery, Dalton, and Brosnan in a forest. That's really good, and I think that's going to tug at a lot of people's emotional strings. Stuff with Brosnan and Jinx, Jinx and her parents, stuff with Judy, and
Lazenby.
Yeah, Lazenby. Actually, yeah, that one's going to be really good. Which is
a risk filming that.
I think one of the most emotional scenes that I've seen so far, or been witness to so far, is a scene between Timothy Dalton and Pierce Brosnan. I will say no more. It's a scene towards the end. So that was, I think, what for me one of the most emotional. I haven't seen some of the others that you're talking about, but I think that
because you filmed it as well, didn't you?
Yeah, I was. I think that's going to be one of the most emotional, purely simply because of the circumstances in that scene. I think that's the one that personally I think is going to get me the most.
Oh yeah, if it's the one I think you're talking about, it's after the forest bit.
Yeah,
that one's gonna be well, probably
heartbreaking.
I think that's one. The audience is going to find the most emotional.
Yeah.
But it's right for the story.
Yeah, that's in the Lazenby one.
But and I think the epilogue.
Oh yeah, that'll be great.
Is going to be a great scene for people to see.
Yeah, that's going to be brilliant.